Today's quotation was Jesus speaking to the rich young ruler, giving him a sovereign word: go and sell what you have and follow me. The authors noted that Jesus gave him opportunity to change the course of his life. Also noted that Jesus didn't stand there and want to argue with him. Jesus didn't chase him down. Jesus didn't even go after him. That rich young ruler chose to go away sad because he chose his will rather than the will of not just a man that was standing there, but the will of the living God that was standing there. The will of the living God offered him apostleship. I find that an amazing thing. He said, come and follow me, face to face, come and follow me. It was a bit rough on me when I was listening to that. I think all the ways inside I still have to conform. But I found it interesting that Jesus didn't try to console the young man. There are many things that the Lord says to us that seems rather hard. But does he have our best interest in mind when he says these things? Did he have this rich young ruler's best interest in mind? This young ruler refused to follow him. We don't know that he ever accepted him. And if he did not, he perished forever. He may have got what he wanted in life, and he may have been religious, but he perished forever. I think Jesus, his Lord, our God, had something to express to him that would save his life. Although it seemed hard to him, there's many things that the Lord speaks to us that he says, just follow me. Do it my way. We can either be sad about it or resist. Or we can finally just say, Lord, what's the song? I surrender all. I surrender. Well, the first place of surrender comes in our will and our disposition. Oh, yes, Lord, I'll do it your way. And all the joys that come when we do it his way. Does God have provision for us? What's his intent? What's God's ultimate intent for us? Does your God have an intent for you and for your life? What was his ultimate design for you? These are not things we often think about in the busyness of life and caring for our children and running back and forth to work and living life on our own terms. However good that may be, it's still on our terms. And as long as we're living in the good, I remind you, that's where Adam and Eve lost it, was living in the good. They didn't live in the evil, they lived in the good. They ate of the tree of good, what they thought was good. She saw it and thought, that's good. That was pleasing to the eyes. She went after what was good, and he did too. And my point in giving you that is, does God have a better plan for us? What was his original intent? In Genesis 1:26-28, God said, let us make man in our image. And I find that absolutely amazing. Our image, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Adam was truly modeled after all three parts of the Godhead. He had the Spirit of God breathed in him. He had the sonship of God in him, being the first man, and the role model. Matter of fact, Adam is quoted, Jesus is quoted to be the second Adam that came to correct the problems that the first Adam brought on the scene. I'm not trying to give Adam a bad rap, but before he failed, what was his positional relationship with God, and what was his destiny that God had designed for him for his project called Planet Earth? And God said, let us make man in our image and according to our likeness. See, he's still working on that part. He's trying to get us to, will you let me make you according to my likeness? See, the Son came down here and did things in the likeness of the Father. He said, not my will be done, but yours. It goes on to say about man. He says, And let us let them rule. That's dominion. That's kingship. In the Hebrew, that's given dominion as a king over something, to rule, to literally rule planet Earth. Adam and Eve ever set in as king and queen over the earth. He says, let them rule in their kingship over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky and over the cattle and over all the earth. How much of the earth? All the earth. And over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. And there's a lot of creepy things that really are ruling over us instead of us ruling over them. And my point in pointing this out to you, God's ultimate intention is to crown us. To crown us. To rule. Now, I can tell you that Eve and Adam decided to take the crown that God gave them and substitute their own crown with their own authority for their own objective, their own purposes, for their own outcome. Wrong crown. Now, there are crowns that demons wear. There are crowns that Satan has. There are crowns that the fallen demonic forces have. Lucifer, when he was made, the crowns that he had, God made the statement, there's none like you. The crowns, the radiances that I've put upon you, the glory I've given you. And he kept talking about the crowns. But one reason that Satan hates mankind is because there was a crown that was given to man that was not given to him, and it was for dominion of earth. That was God's intention for Adam, to have dominion on planet Earth. He didn't leave anything out. Adam had the complete knowledge of God. He knew how the electrons and the molecules and protons of this Earth were put together. Matter of fact, some of the knowledge that man is just now beginning to discover through scientific engineering and through some of the electron microscopes and chemistry that we've made discovery of, man had all that knowledge to begin with when he was in the garden. He was no caveman sitting in a cave. He had a complete understanding of the molecular structure of every tree and planet Earth. And I don't want this to be where we're headed, but I have to explain to you God's intent for man was a very good intent. And he has never changed his thought process. He's never changed his objective and his intent for us. Matter of fact, in one book in the New Testament, he says that he is making us into kings and priests, does it not? That's his objective still. But it's the new man that gets made into that, not the old man. The old man cannot be made into that. And the problem is, if we rule in our flesh, we do what Adam and Eve does, or what the rich young ruler did. He wanted to continue to rule. If he would have laid down his money, he also would have lost his rulership, because back then you bought your seat of power with your money. So he would have been giving up his rulership over the people. Instead, Christ was giving him rulership in his kingdom. If you'd come and follow me. And there's only 12 men that he went to and said, come and follow me. Only 12 men on planet Earth that the living God said, come and follow me. Now, I ask you, do you think his life would have been filled with something that was worthwhile if he had followed Jesus? Was Peter's life filled with the inexpressible joys of God and the riches of Jesus Christ's kingdom? Was Paul filled with that? Was John filled? Every one of the disciples turned into apostles, two apostles. The 12 disciples turned into apostles. Ones that were sent because they stayed with Jesus and let him renew them inside of becoming a new man. It's only the new man that can rule on planet Earth. And that rulership begins not in me ruling over you, but me ruling my own spirit, bringing it under the lordship of Jesus Christ. Every one of us, when we're small little children, we crown ourselves as king, and we struggle with our parents and with any authority that's over us. No, I don't want to do it that way. I want to be king. I want to be king. Christ will not make himself ruler over you. You have to conquer yourself and bring yourself to him. Say, here I am, Lord. Not my will, but yours be done. Now, there's something I want to show you that Tristan's going to put up on the board here, that there's a direct dichotomy between us and the kings of Israel. We're going to start from the first king of Israel. God originally told the Israelites, I'll be your God. I'll be the one to direct you. I'll be the one to make the laws. I'll be the one to make the judgments. You obey my priest and you obey my spiritual leaders. The people, after getting to Israel and getting everything they wanted and getting free houses and free camels and free vineyards and free everything was provided for them. When they come into a land flowing with milk and honey, they began to say, we don't want you as our leader. We don't want your priest to tell us what to do. We don't want their instruction. We don't want their insight. We want to have kings like the rest of the nations. God told Samuel, they're not resisting you. They're rejecting me. I'll give them a king. God gave them Saul, and there's a passage of scripture in Psalms that says, I gave you a king because I was angry with you, and in my wrath I dealt with him. God gave them a king. But what most people don't understand is Samuel set down a whole set of laws that the king was supposed to fulfill as God's agent. Now, I'm not suggesting we go crown somebody king. That's not my point. My point is kings are only in existence if we're resistant to God's leadership. So if we want to be king in our lives, we're resisting God's leadership. Now, I want you to note something about these kings. Saul, he was considered kind of righteous, but yet he really dipped in his righteousness because he didn't obey what God says. It was an Amalekite king. The Amalekites had killed many of the Israelites. The Amalekites really mistreated the Israel when they were walking through the land. And God used the Amalekites. He for those who were stragglers, he let the Amalekites get them. And when it come time for God to judge one of the Amalekite kings, he went down to sent Samuel, told Saul, take an army down, conquer this place, and kill everything that's there. Don't keep any sheep, don't keep any cattle, don't keep any of it. All of it is supposed to be burned. It belongs to the Amalekites. Well, they let this Amalekite, or Saul let this Amalekite king live because he wanted the cattle, he wanted the sheep, he wanted everything. And he couldn't justify killing just the king and keeping the sheep and the cattle. He wanted the riches that were there. And when God said, you burn it, don't bring nothing back. It's an atrocity to me, and I don't want it in my land. Well, Saul come prancing back with it. And when Samuel met him, he said, what have you done? I just brought him back so we could give sacrifices to God. And Samuel said, no way. And Samuel killed the guy himself, the king himself, following God's instructive, directive word. Now, Saul resisted God, and as a result, the whole kingdom was stripped from him because God considered it, I crowned you king, and you won't do what I said do. Therefore, the kingdom will be stripped from you, and his garments were ripped. He reached for Samuel and Samuel's garment, and he told him the kingdom's going to be stripped from you and from your household forever because you were unwilling as a king to be obedient to God when God is the one that appointed you. God's the one that certified you. Now, I have a reason for telling you this because you can see some of the kings did. Saul, he dipped off into the sin area by disobeying God. Now, David comes along and he starts out with his harp really waltzing and really climbs and climbs and climbs. This is a pleasing chart and a displeasing chart to God of their life. Now, I don't know if you know this or not. There's going to be a chart in heaven that shows your life of whether you were righteous, whether you followed his directives, whether you followed his instructions. Our lives can be coined just like theirs can. Were we doing what God's will, or did we change God's will and do God's will our way, or did we do our way and call it God's will? So David did God's will all the way to the point that he got involved with Bathsheba. When he got involved with Bathsheba, he really went downhill, and he lost God's favor. Matter of fact, God's judgment come up on the whole nation as a result of it. And finally, David, there's 20-something thousand people that died. And when David intentionally did a sin, David had a guy put to death so he could steal his wife. Now, that's pretty serious. And the guy loved David, and he was one of his faithful captains. And he was sent in to purposely be killed. Now, that's an atrocity for someone that belongs to God and was so close to God to plot to do so that he could steal something when he had the whole kingdom. Any girl he wanted, instead, he wanted that man's and had that man killed. Pretty serious thing. Now, he redeemed himself by repenting. He redeemed himself by following the instructive law of offering a sacrifice. And he came back into righteousness, but he had a serious fall. That's on record for us. How would you like your records read in the future? Some of them I want buried. Matter of fact, some of them I want the Lord to throw it in the sea of forgetfulness so you'll have to read it. So it didn't have to be announced in the heavenlies. Now, my point in giving you this, these guys are kings. We got Solomon that started out on a high peak, doing what God's will, praying, oh God, if I want to rule this people, I asked only for one thing. I need wisdom because they're your people and you're the one, your God, you're going to be looking on. And how can I do that? And God gave him the greatest wisdom on planet Earth. And he said, I'll never endow another man with that much wisdom. But then we see Solomon after he paves the streets with silver. There's one comment about the streets being paved with silver and silver being as cheap as dirt there. He had gold mines all over Africa, and it's amazing the amount of gold that this guy, richest nation on earth, far exceeding the wealth of the U.S. and even the world's economy, even back then. Everything was absolutely amazing. And David alone gave 67 of those huge dump truck, 67 dump truck loads of gold just for the building of the temple. That doesn't include what else was accumulated nor what Solomon put in. But Solomon is the one that became wealthy, not David. So what does that tell you about the wealth that he had? Anyway, my point in giving you that is he went to a very high peak in his wealth as a result of his following what God had to say, but then began to fall off because he got involved in not doing God's will, God's way. And finally, he got involved in just gross sin. And that sin led him down into the depths of idolatry. And when he went into idolatry, something happened. The offspring that began to take over and rule after that was Rehoboam in 2 Chronicles. Now, 2 Chronicles is a very interesting book. It outlines for us the good kings and the bad kings and the outcome of the nation as a result of their poor leadership or their good leadership. There was five different reformations that occurred with different kings, but there was, oh my goodness, there was a whole herd of kings that just brought havoc upon the nation. And Rehoboam is the one that actually set the stage that caused the family of God to be split in half. Did you realize that? See, the nation split into Judah and into Israel. Because he took them so far into idolatry, he split up the family of God. And I can tell you, in our own lives, if we've got the idol of mammon or the idol of our own ways, our own purposes, our own action, all those things are idols. If we have those idols, they're beyond sin because they're what owns us, they're what controls us, and we worship those things, then we actually will see our families disintegrate as a result of not having our hands and our heart into the mindset of God and into his purposes. Instead, we're in idolatry. So the nation, it was decided for the nation with Rehoboam that the nation would be split in two. Now, there were some real bad things that took place, and there's another king that come along, but finally, there's a king that starts coming up on the scene that, if I can get this thing to go on here.
No, that's the laser pointer.
Oh, it's the laser pointer. That's what you were doing with the little red dot thing, huh? I can only be trusted with a laser pointer, and I don't know how it works. So, oh, what's that? we had Asa come on the scene. Asa was an amazing king that really had a heart for God and saw all the deprivation of the nation and began to change things and began to get the nation to try to come back to God. He destroyed many of the idols that were set up. He destroyed many of the gods that were worshipped right there in the inner courts. He really did well. But then he, at the end of his reign as a king, he dipped off into sin. See, it seems like when we get to doing well with what God gives us, now we go spend it on ourselves, we don't have time for God, and we end up falling in some sort of sin. Now, that sin doesn't have to be in adultery. It doesn't have to be into smoking dope. Sin is not accomplishing what God wants done. Do you realize that? Sin is not accomplishing what God wants done. It's us doing our thing our way. And that can be a good thing. We can think, well, this is good. I got this plan. Sin is not accomplishing God's will. So Asa finished the race right here at kind of a dip. And Jehoshaphat comes on the scene. Jehoshaphat was amazing because he started out just kind of down here in the sin realm because there was some idolatry that kept in. There were some sinful things that kings did. And he began to read the Word of God, and he got real serious about it. And his righteousness went straight up, and he's one of the few kings that ended at a high point in his relationship with God. He did not turn back, and he did not dip back down. He stayed in total righteousness with the living God. Now, I have a reason for showing you all this. You can see that there's another king right after that. He started where he left off, and he just went straight down all the way into idolatry. And, boy, I'm telling you, Ahaz and Joram and all these guys really took the nation. Now, Joash, he made some changes and come back up and went into pinnacle, but then he went back down into my way. I'll do it my way. And then this guy did the same thing, and then he dropped down so far, he finally just started serving the god of mammon and other things and made it all the way back down here into idolatry. Now, Uzziah was a real interesting character. He saw where the nation was. He was not real close to God, but he started looking at the Word and becoming obedient to God. And his relationship with the Lord soared, and it took the nation right back into righteousness along with him. He didn't finish too far down, but he did dip into sin in his latter years, because when he became successful, then he began to get into my way again, dip back down. We've got another guy here. It's Jotham. And he was successful for a time, and then all of a sudden you can just see. I mean, it's just amazing the change that took place. Now, can we go on to the next one? Here we have Hezekiah. Hezekiah started in sin, and then he really got into God's word, and as a result of being obedient to God, climbed up and stayed up. Hezekiah was another one of those. So I see only three kings that achieved finding out the truth of God, living by the truth of God, establishing the truth of God as their lifestyle, and the purposes of God as their purposes. He was one of those, and he was an amazing, amazing king. Now, then we got Josiah. We got a bunch of doofuses that are in between, that were up and down, and really took the nation to a bunch of, because of what these bad kings did, that brought on the captivity of Babylon that took place. They lost their whole nation as a result of what some of these kings did. And the only reprieve they had happened as a result of these other three kings that lived in righteousness. And Josiah was one of those also. Now, my point in talking about the bad things that some of these kings did, and the three good kings, I should say four. David was a good king. He came back into it. We look at them and see they destroyed their lives. They destroyed Israel, some of them. We don't think much of them because of some of their kingship and them getting caught up in their own antics, their own lives, their own ways. But if God has said to us, I'm making you kings and priests in this life. He's given you, as a new man belonging to him, he wants to put you into kingship over your life, that you can rule over your life. Will you raise this and turn that light on, Mark? There's a spiritual message in the mix of the book, the Second of Chronicles. That spiritual message is rich to us. It shows the overall plan of God and the responses of God if we respond to his instructive ways. The spiritual lessons are the preeminence of his wisdom that he endows through the Spirit, giving us understanding to accomplish what he wants done under his directives. The second thing, the spiritual lesson, is the glory of the Lord. It can fill the temple. If the glory of the Lord fills the temple, what happens to the rest of our life? It gets filled with him too, right? And that spills over into everything that we're going to supposedly accomplish in life. Just like these men were predestined to do something for God, we saw three of them accomplished it. Right? Well, actually four. David accomplished some things too. Three of them accomplished and finished really well. Out of that, God had crowned them and they successfully walked into the leadership that he established for them to have. If I'm to have a crown, and I don't know if you know this or not, we're supposed to be crowned. The new man is supposed to be crowned. There's a crown of righteousness. There's a crown of joy. There's a crown of life. There's several different crowns that the Lord wants to come and crown us with. Now, he cannot crown you if you're a boy or a little girl. All he can do is put you under tutors and governors until the appointed time. And to the degree that we either listen to the instruction and become obedient, or the degree that we resist is the determination as to whether we will be given a crown or not. Do you understand? If you have an unruly child, you don't let them rule, do you? If my girls were unruly, they didn't get to rule in nothing, including themselves. They were ruled over as a result of their unruliness. God has not changed his ways. We are ruled over by life and everything in it, if we don't make him Lord of Lords. He wants you to be Lord of your life in submission to him, right? Lord of Lords, King of Kings. There's a reason he said King of Kings. It's just not talking about these guys. It's talking about the new man in you that's supposed to subdue the flesh man, subdue your personality, subdue your purposes, that you live your life for the living God. Jesus said, I'm giving my life for you. Now let me live my life in you. You're not supposed to be living your life. You're supposed to be letting him live his life in you. Now I ask you, if he's in you, are there places you're taking him that he would be somebody someplace else doing something for his Father? Do you understand that statement? Jesus, if Jesus is going to reside in you, or the Holy Spirit's going to reside in you, Holy Spirit says, Jesus, he would be about the Father's business over there. And what are you doing over there? Oh, I want to go. I might share Jesus with somebody over here. I'm not doing God's will, God's way. Instead, I'm trying to do my will, and I'm still Lord, making Jesus have to follow me. Now, the rich young ruler, did Jesus follow after the rich young ruler? He did not. And if you've prospered enough in this life and you want to rule, Jesus is not going to chase after you either. He's not going to chase you down. He's not going to make you subordinate to him. He wants his children to recognize him as King of Kings and recognize that any crown that I have in this life of leadership or rulership, beginning with myself and then second with my family, any crown that I'm going to have has to be submitted to him. I remind you of the 24 elders in heaven. What was the first thing they did? They removed their crowns and laid them at the foot of the crown, foot of the throne, at his feet. Their crowns were subjective to his rulership over their crowns. Their crowns belonged to him, and they recognized their crowns belonged to him. Now, by way of point of understanding where we're headed with this, is that crown is not a new thing. It's something that we actually can earn by, one, our obedience, two, our patience, three, our suffering, four, and I can go on. But I want you to know that even the priesthood, the high priest received a crown too. Did you know that? He wore a crown. I find that absolutely interesting that God would take his high priest. He would put all these special things on him. Exodus, let's go to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy kind of says it better. And it shall be, when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom, that he shall write him a copy. No, I'm in the wrong one. Leviticus chapter 8. And Moses said unto the congregation, this is the thing which the Lord hath commanded to be done. Who commanded it? And Moses brought Aaron and his son and washed him with water, and he put upon him the coat and girded him with the girdle and clothed him with the robe and put an ephod upon him. And he girded him with the curious girdle of the ephod, and he bound it upon him therewith. And he put the breastplate upon him, and he also put the breastplate of the Urim and the Thummim. And then he put the mitre upon his head, and upon the mitre, even upon his forefront, did he put the golden plate. Now, if you read up in Exodus, it says that that golden plate was a crown that was put on his head. Now, why did God crown him in front of everybody? After he crowned him, he anointed him. Now, if you noticed, he put all the vestments up on him, and then he crowned him. And you know the last things that were put into the vestment? After that, the Urim and the Thummim. Remember the stone of truth and the stone of light. Out of the stone of truth, the voice of God would speak. But before the voice of God would speak, the Urim would brilliantly cast out light to the point. Some of the ancient rabbinicals say people were all, the whole crowds were blinded when God would speak to the high priest, that the Urim would burst forth with a starburst of light, and then the Thummim, the voice of God, would begin to speak to the high priest out of the Thummim. Did you ever wonder how the high priest would inquire of God? That's a pretty significant thing to be recorded in Scripture. All nations considered those two stones to be absolute oracles. In other words, something from God. All other nations that had other gods considered those two stones to be absolutely an oracle from the God of gods, because they really had a witness that those things work. Now, my point in giving you that, those two things were not set in place unless the crown was put on. Right? So if we're going to be priests and kings, both ways, we get crowned for something in the kingdom of God. You're not crowned to rule. If you're crowned king, that means you're supposed to subdue planet Earth for God and change planet Earth for him like his son. What is his son? Was his son busy about the father's business when he was here on Earth? If you want to be crowned in this life, you're going to have to get busy about the father's business. When you get busy about the Father's business, then a crown is available for you to begin to be put upon. Now, we do lots of things in our own spirit, out of our own will. Do you realize what would happen if you had a true official crown from God? Demonic forces see it, they back away. Angelic forces see it. Ah, he's authorized. I'm supposed to be act upon this. And you have the authority because I see God's crown upon you. He crowned you to accomplish this. There's all kinds of power that comes in, spiritual power that comes in, if we begin to wear the crowns that God wants to place upon us. Now, Samuel, or Revelation 4, chapter 4. After this, I looked, and there before me was a door standing open in heaven. And a voice I had first heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. At once I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven with someone sitting on it. The one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian, jasper that's diamonds, and a rainbow resembling an emerald encircling the throne. Surrounding the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders, and they were dressed in white and had crowns of gold on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumbles and peals of thunder, and before the throne seven lamps were blazing. They were the seven spirits of God. Also before the throne, there was what looked like a sea of glass as clear as crystal. In the center around the throne were four living creatures, and they were covered with eyes in the front and back. And the first living creature was like a lion, the second like an ox, the third the face of a man, the fourth was like a flying eagle. Each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under the wings. Day and night they never stopped saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Now, my point in giving you this passage of Scripture is to draw a picture for you. Here we see the 24 elders. We see thrones, which means there's something that they rule over, because a throne always represents dominion over a kingdom. A crown means the power to rule that kingdom. If there's an empty throne, there's no one to rule. You remember John, when he saw the throne, it was empty. And he began to weep because no one was found. And finally, the throne was filled with the Lamb. The throne received its king, and when it did, then he was crowned with honor and splendor and glory by everyone who had other crowns, realizing that their crowns were directly connected to his crown, and they would not have a crown if he was not crowned. Now, my point in giving you that, we wander around in this life like goats instead of sheep, doing our own thing our own way, and not realizing that God's ultimate intent in making us a new creature is that we might be trained as a child of God to be about the Father's business and to be ruler of our own spirit, to be ruler of that deep down thing inside that wants to be a resister of God. Now why? Because an heir has everything provided for him, does he not? An heir, how much does Jesus own? And as long as I don't, as long as I'm not in heirship, as if I'm in heiror, those are the two ways we can go, in heiror or heirship. If I'm in heirship, in other words, there's something from God that can be passed on to me through Lord Jesus Christ, and that's the complete provisions for planet Earth to accomplish his will. These men that we saw that were crowned king got complete provision. When they began to walk in the righteousness of God, their nations come out of the poorhouse, and then food and everything was made for them, and they became a good nation with abundance. Whenever they turned from God and no longer they took their leadership into their own ways, now the nation went the opposite direction and they had to provide for themselves. God's abundance was cut off because they stopped being an heir and went into error. My whole thought process is that we might catch a picture that God's intent, however hard it may seem, is to make me a leader and ruler of my flesh, that I might come into his nature, so I can come into his provision. And if I come into his provision with his nature, that he also positionally places me because of my obedience with the crown to accomplish the will of my Father here on earth. If I begin to accomplish the will of my Father, there is nothing that I will have need of. His provisions are fully made to accomplish everything on planet Earth that he wants to accomplish. Do you realize how hard the Lord has to look to and fro on the face of the earth for someone he can trust with finances? Could he, if he gave Jesus $1 trillion, what would Jesus have spent $1 trillion on? What would he? Huh? Oh, hey, you know what? I probably can get a whole caravan of jewels and stuff like that. I'll build a huge palace. Everybody will know I'm king, and then they'll serve the Father. He was offered all those things by Satan. What would he have spent $1 trillion on? Accomplishing the Father's will. Now, if he was accomplishing the Father's will, do you think that $1 trillion would have run out? No. My point is God has for us economically and physically, psychologically and relationally, everything we will need if we become kings under him. None of those things are available if we're still little children. We're still just placed under other authorities. We'll never rule our own spirits, and we'll never come into our kingship, and we'll never enter into the inheritance that he had here on the face of the earth for us. We'll end up working 3 jobs. We'll end up working ourselves in the ground. Well, if you don't give your time, your effort, your money, your life, your heart, everything that's within you to your God, then you're going to give your time, your money, your effort to everything that the enemy wants to do. Because if you're not wearing a crown, guess who else has a crown? Satan does. That means he has authority. And he can come and take what you have because of his authority, and you have none. Now, I would suggest to you, somebody was sharing with me a dream, and in it they were on a rocket sled that was propelling them towards the Lord, and they saw this creature that was trying to hang on to the rocket sled, and it got going so fast that the creature was thrown off of it. If we're doing God's will, God's way, he draws us into his presence so fast that the enemy cannot hang on any longer. If we're not doing God's will, God's way, then the rocket sled's not going. We can't outrun that creature of darkness, and we will end up having to fight on its terms. And we cannot defeat the creatures of darkness. We can only let Jesus defeat the creature of darkness by his great power of drawing us deeper into his presence. We cannot be drawn deeper into his presence unless we, like the rich young ruler, instead of becoming despondent about, well, I guess you're going to order me to do something else. I guess I'll have to do it. If we're becoming despondent, he went away sad. He did not have to go away sad. And I ask you, do you think if he was a rich young ruler that God had greater riches for him? I would suggest to you, yes. If he'd have given away everything, God may have multiplied 10 times what he had, because he needed somebody to handle the finances in his kingdom to perpetuate the kingdom of his dear son. I know one person that's a multimillionaire, makes about $10 million a month in excess profits. And his biggest nightmare, what do I do with it? Man, he flies all over the country. Where can I give it? What can I do? He can't give it away fast enough. But I've also noted in some of his later years, he's built himself quite an empire for him and for his children, and he's not putting as much interest in doing those things of the Lord anymore. As a result, I have noted that his children have drifted from God. They have no heart for God because he lost his heart for what God gave him finances for and purposes for. His children are now drifting away from God. Why? Because God made him for an intent purpose, raised him up with the man being a really righteous man, serving God, doing it God's way. God entrusted him. He did for a long time, but when there started being mega bucks on the table, it was too much. I don't know if I can give it. I mean, I could establish a bigger business. Do you see the chart of the kings coming into play? Now, the king chart is in play upon you, too. God has his ultimate purpose for us is a provision of what we need in this life. But his provision is for his children, for his obedient servants, and for those who want to become kings and priests in his kingdom. His provision is not for the world, and it is not for those who do not want to be obedient children. Now, I'm not trying to get you to do anything other than be obedient to your Lord in this message. I want you to see the benefits of serving your God, because I can't get you into the place that you can live in abundance unless you become that. I can tell you, when I was pastoring in Texas, when we started a ragtag group, half the people starving to death, late bills, almost always losing their house, late on payments, and barely pulling through. Many times we help such people with such things. They lived in abject poverty as a result of their disobedience to God. But once they finally learned how to be obedient to God, did you know every one of those families is well off today? They own their houses. They have good businesses. They've gone on to become businessmen and business owners of successful businesses. People that were hardworking for other people but that could never make ends meet, because they began to put the principles of God into practice. God first, God first, God first. God is it. God's the one that's doing it. God's the one that's blessing. God's the one that's multiplying the business. His kingdom comes first. When they got that intact in their heart, it changed the criteria of their life, and it changed the financial outcome. It changed the outcome of their children. The people who have that in their heart, their children now are serving the Lord too, instead of drifting. Now, we can play games and not become a king of our own soul. Well, I guess we are a pretend king, aren't we? If we haven't submitted ourselves to him, we have no crown to wear, so we're a pretend king. But if we can get ourselves in that position, give up our rich young rulership of what we hope that we might accomplish, and say, Lord, I've tried for years to do it my way, my will. And there's always this vicious circle of ups and downs and emptinesses. And Lord, I want to do things your way. Now, if you keep going up and then you lose everything, and you keep going up and you lose everything, well, why not start at that losing place and try it a different way? Go up in him. Because if you go up in him, you'll stay up. If you don't go up in him, you can work 10 jobs and still not make enough. Why? Because there's another guy that's got crowns, and he has authority to take what you have. If you don't have a crown, he does. He was crowned with many crowns. He has power and authority. He came to kill, steal, and destroy. He has the crowns to accomplish it, unless you have a crown to keep him away. Your crown is your humility. Your crown is your loving faithfulness to your Lord. Your crown comes from obedience to your God. I wish to have had the paper, because I have quite a bit of notes for you that regards to the crowns of joy. If you're lacking joy in your life, it's because you're lacking obedience to your Lord. Because one of the crowns that comes in life is joy as a result of him crowning you with it, as a result of your obedience. Matter of fact, if we're willing to suffer and say no to the flesh man, there's another crown. It's called the crown of life. And you know what life is supposed to be? The word Zoe means the inhabited presence of the breath of God being led by him into the perpetualness of his eternal blessing and fellowship. You want me to repeat that? It's not woohoo, life, I get to kick up my heels and the sun's gone. No. God breathed life into Adam. It was the breath of God, the coexisting purposes, the coexisting pleasure and reality of the functionality of being connected to the living God and seeing everything through his eyes and being connected to him in everything. If we're not connected to him in everything, we're not living life. Because if we're connected to him, then we can see things through his eyes. If you see things through Jesus' eyes, you see things totally different. There was a girl there in the mall that works at Subway, and I've been in there several times to order a sandwich and take the workmen over there when we didn't have food and stuff. And I would have her, you know, would you put my meat on her? Yes. And boy, she just scowled. Would you put the onions on there first? Oh. Would you put the olives on there next? Oh. She hated, she seen me coming, she, you know, she's got these dark mascara in her eyes. Oh, he's coming again, you know. Just hated it. And what it come out to be was I was messing up her order of what she puts on the sandwich when it was supposed to be put on the sandwich according to her. I thought, oh, Lord. But then she began to dump on some of you guys. Some of you commented that you didn't want to go there no more as a result of the bad actions of this young lady and her bad attitudes. I went over and I said, can I talk with you? And I shared with her that there's some of our people that don't want to come here no more. I don't want to go to your boss and stir up trouble for you. But is it right to treat people that way? I mean, your company could use our business. I'm not going to your boss. I'm not reporting this. But can you see something wrong here? And she resisted at first, but then she embraced the truth. And she said, you know, I there's somebody here at this job I just absolutely hate. And then I don't like, you know, I like to put lettuce on first. And sorry. I went away and I went, okay, Lord, there's hope for that girl. And he said, you know, there's some other things she's gone through and involved in. It's a real sad life behind the scenes. Going through some real hurtful time and unsure time. Pray for her. I said, Lord, we're going to be here in this mall, and I sure don't want to be in a situation that I've offended somebody by sharing truth. I saw that girl today sitting at a bus stop with her little baby. Probably no father involved. No finances involved. The real bitternesses of life there as a result of all the pressures of life, of not having provisions and stuff. My heart goes out to her. If I could express anything to her, it would be, oh, find the Lord. You're going to need it. Your child's going to need it. It'll change the outcome of your life. Find him. Learn to be his child. Oh, fine. I saw our little girl. I just thought, oh, Lord, she could be a light of this life. Your heavy, the heavy burdens that she's under, that her rulership has brought her into, if she could just change that rulership to your rulership, certainly it wouldn't be as heavy as a burden as the burden that she has. See, we somehow, and I find it ironic that the Lord says, come to me, all you are who are heavy burdened. And then he talks about us putting on his yoke. We, oh, I don't know about that yoke. It looks heavy. Man, it is not near as heavy as the dead bodies. We're dragging a whole mule team. They're all dead back there, you know? And we think, why is it so hard? I mean, come on, you guys, you're not pulling. Oh, they're supposed to be in front, aren't they? And they're dead. They're not pulling. Our flesh man cannot pull in this life. He cannot rule. He cannot do anything except cause us problems. And we should not. Our heart should be different. It should not be like the rich young ruler that went away sad and despondent because he didn't want to do the God's will. God's will is for our good. It's to get us into position for the provisions in life that we need. They're good. We have to change our heart about what he wants and why he wants it. Now, he didn't always give us an explanation. He just says, do this. Well, I don't know about that. You know, I don't know about that. Always saying that. When inside, we should realize, I want to enter you into your airship. I want your plans for my life. I can't see how it fits, but it says I'm not supposed to do it. And I got to check out. I'm not supposed. I won't do that anymore. All the kings began to make discovery about God's word. It was one of those young lads that became king. And God's word had not been seen for probably 100 years. And one of the priests come in. Hey, we were digging around and we actually found a manuscript. We found some of the Bible. And he read it. They read it and they wept. They had drifted so far from God. They weren't even keepers of his word. They didn't even know what it was. They found a portion of it, and it changed the course of the entire nation. And I'm telling you that if we make discovery of God's word and begin to rule under his leadership, our lives, everything will change. It couldn't be any worse than we've made it. It couldn't be as bad as the rich young ruler thought of, oh, I have to give up my position in the council. I can't impress anybody in the government, and I won't be able to buy my seat there. And besides that, you know, I would be broke. How could I glorify God that, you know, not having what I want? Not doing it my way. It was not a man who made him the offer. It was the living God. He makes each one of us the same offer. He says, will you let me train you as a son, as a daughter? Will you let me train you to become a new man to rule? Will you let me train you so that I can objectively set a day that I can put crowns of righteousness on you? That I can put a crown of joy upon you, that I can put a crown of life upon you, that I can put crowns of provision, crowns of my promises, crowns of my truth, crowns of my presence, crowns of the revelatory purposes of God, crowns of the encounters with the living. Will you let me crown you with these things? Because if you're resistive and want to do it your way, you cannot wear these crowns. We need those crowns. They're available for us now so that we might know our God. There's something else about a crown. If you have on a crown, you have admittance before his throne. Every one of the elders had on a crown, and as a result, they had admittance before the throne of the living God. So if you have petitions that need to be brought before the throne of God without a crown, all you can do is pass them on. If you gain some crowns, you firsthand can lay those at his feet. There are some great tragedies that will occur in our life. When those do occur, if we have not gained the crowns, we will not have the access to lay them at his feet. We can cry from a distance. We can petition him and send them from a distance. But they are from a distance because we are at a distance. We are not where we should have been as a righteous son, like his son, doing the Father's will. If we stand off now, we'll be off then. If you're on the other side of the universe doing your will, your way, then you're going to be crying out to a God who is on the other side of the universe because you are in your will and your way. I'm not saying he cannot hear. There's many times he heard me when I was on the other side of the universe and rescued me. But it was me who made the decision to come from the other side of the universe and become his son. Let him be Lord over my life, king, until he would make me king over some areas of my life. With that kingship and with that crown that he's placed upon me, I've personally shared with you many, many instances of having encounters with him. It's because of the crowns, you too will begin to have encounters with him. Because if you have a crown, you have admittance into his presence. If you do not have a crown, you may belong to him, but you do not have a right to go into the throne room. Do you want that right? Because these rights that we're talking about has nothing to do with our eternal salvation. They have to do with our perpetual relationship. I'm the one that makes a decision to live on the other side of the universe or to be a pillar in the house of my God. I do that by submitting myself, becoming an heir of righteousness, getting myself into position to receive the instruction to the point that I can learn to rule my flesh, my mouth, my attitudes. And the Lord says, to you who have overcome, I'll come to you and I'll give you a new crown. And with that, I'm going to give you a new stone with a new name written in it. The only stones I know of that are white was, guess what? The Urim. It was a white, brilliant white stone. It was the only one in the vestment of the priest who wore the crown. So whether you're a priest, there's still a crown that you're supposed to wear. He was insubmissive to the Lord. Matter of fact, male men are not supposed to wear hats because it defames God when they come into his presence. However, the priest was commanded, you cover your head before me. You're my servant, and you show it before other people. But upon your covering, I'm going to put a crown. It showed total submission and service to the other people when they put on the hats. Do you understand that? That's why women are supposed to cover their head in church when they speak, and showing signs of submission to the husband. And now God sees that and says, oh, okay, we got everything in right order. Well, guess what? The priest, he was supposed to wear a hat too. Why? To show the people he's in submission to God and he was their servant. But then God took the priest and he said, the high priest, and now let me put a crown on that hat since you're my servant. You'll catch all these little things that are in there. That is so cool, the word is. Your God has such great intent for you and such great plans for you. A destiny of this life, it is a good life, it is a joyful life, it is full of his will, not yours. You cannot figure these things out on your own. You have to have your Lord Jesus. You have to have the infilling of the Spirit. You have to have the Word. You also need a shepherd. Four things that you need in order to be equipped to know your God and to be crowned. Shall we pray? But I can't tell you how many times I've gone away despondent, thinking your word and instructive things that you say, oh, that's hard, Lord. How can I do that? But how can I not do it? I've found how hard life is by not doing it your way. I say, I don't trust it's you I don't trust. If I just fall into line, obedience and submission, won't you be my protector? Won't you watch out after me? Lord, you have for years led me through many, many things, put me under many tutelage, always training me be your son, to become an heir. Always training me to give up myself a little bit more. A few times, I acted like the rich young ruler. But you caught my attention and said, oh, Curtis, the plans I have for you, I thank you. I thank you. Because I will not resist you. I want all of your plans for my life to be established. You come and rule. Teach me to rule. Teach me to be your obedient servant. And crown me with your glorious presence. Not for others to look at, but that I might have the benefit of knowing your glorious presence abides with me. If your abiding presence is here, what is there that the enemy could do? And what is there that I would not want to do for you? I ask you, plant this word within our hearts, that we might have new purposes in being your children. That we might have a new heart in wanting to receive your training. That we would chase you down, cry out for you to train us. We thank you. Give us a heart to receive your word. In Jesus' name, amen. To give you a moment, if the Lord was speaking to you in this. Remember, this is not a time for a testimony about something else. Don't connect it to something else. How did God clearly speak to you out of his instructive word in this session? I do this because if our sovereign Lord has spoken, it certainly requires a response from us. Moses was standing on the mountain. God says, Moses, do you think he needed to respond to him? So if you've truly heard the Lord, not a man, but heard the Lord, what is your response to him? What proclamation would you like to declare? What truth did he give you? What do you desire from him? Ball's in your court. I'll give you a couple of minutes before we close.
This message has been a timely warning for me. God has been so good. But I've been starting to make plans for myself that I didn't ask him if this was something he wanted. And I want to do what he has planned, because his plans are perfect, and I just praise God that he is leading me and that he will show me his plan at each step in each way. Praise God.
Lord, do you hear my sister's request? I ask you to meet her. Direct her steps. Anyone else?
This was an encouraging word, and I realize how in my heart, and when I hear this word, how desperately I want to be submitted and to obey. But how aware I am that though my spirit is willing, the flesh is weak. And I I pray and ask for that kind of strength, spiritual strength, to truly rule over the flesh in my own life.
Anyone else?
It was just kind of after towards the end of what you were saying, it was just dawning on me that that waiting on the Lord is actually letting Him go first, actually letting Him be King and Lord, and be our leader. And I never had seen that before, when we're not ruling our own spirit, we're not waiting on Him. We'll like Rosalind said, we'll jump ahead and start making our own plans or whatever. But it's just I just realized that waiting on Him is really living a life in submitting our purposes and our plans and our will, and so it's cool.
Scripture says those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. That strength that's used there is the same terminology that's used for dominion, rulership as a king. Those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, shall remove their dominionship under His crown and His lordship.
As you were talking, I could see how important and how necessary this is, and my whole heart desires it. But I kept saying, Lord, how do I do this? How do I get there? How do I? And I think Rosalind, what you just said really has struck me, and you too, Jackie, that it's waiting, it's stopping and not allowing our impulsive self to jump in with both feet, but say, Lord, how do you want me to respond to this? What do you want me to do with this? What do I need to own it, or do I need to give it to you? How do you want me to respond?
Yes. Would you turn me up, Tristan? Thank you.
I really appreciated when you said that about those scriptures and revelations to He who overcomes. And I've always felt in my heart that it was the overcoming of the self. And so when you said He who overcomes, my flesh, my mouth, my attitudes, that's His ruling. That's His reigning in us. And, you know, I'm so thankful that the training that He gives us, and even those scriptures that came to my mind in Hebrews when it says, you know, the discipline and the training of the Lord is grievous and painful at times, but it yields the peaceful fruit, and we will reap, you know, if we don't grow weary. And so I just am encouraged that this is, you know, He who overcomes, and we just need Him to enable us to overcome that mouth and flesh and attitudes.
Mm-hmm. I was just thinking about what you said about the new man and His purposes for the new man, and how complicated we can make that sometimes when His purpose is to be king of our life, you know, and bringing myself into submission to His kingship. So anyway.
Well, I thought you got a protocol here. I'm just trying to be obedient.
Actually, Curtis, what I got was at the tail end here. I thank you for sharing the story about the girl and the baby. I'm pretty sure my deal would have been, if I had seen her at a bus stop, I'm pretty sure I would have found a place to park and gone and talked to her and tried to offer something. And it's so apparent why you're the shepherd and I'm the sheep, because I would have told Pat and maybe four or five people, maybe. But you just told 25 people and encouraged us to pray for her. And your way's better than mine was. Thanks.
Anyone else? Elton?
I heard a connection between this message and the one you spoke on Saturday night about passing judgments on his judgments. And rich young ruler, so it, I mean, I've asked this, the same question in different ways to the Lord. And I got thinking tonight, why ask the question if you don't want the answer or an answer, unless you think the answer is going to line up with what you have already, I have already presupposed the answer will be. But the answer is the right one, because the judgments are true. I don't know all there is about my life. I don't know. The young ruler didn't know all about his either. And he went away sad and dejected. I have too. I've gone away from saying, Lord, I don't like that answer. Get away from me, Satan, get behind me. Because that isn't obviously the Lord speaking, but it is, and it was. But I'd ruled on his rule. I'd made a judgment on his judgment. And so what I got out of this is, when I ask a question, have an open heart to hear an answer, and then to say, oh, Lord, your judgments, oh, they're good. When I first came here, you mentioned that. One of the first things I remember you saying, because judgments always had a negative connotation to me. I always saw judgment as the gavel falling and a conviction pronounced and a sentence and some penalty associated with it. I never saw a judgment associated with anything other than something negative. But I have a completely different perspective about that now, because his judgments, I want his judgments, I want his rulings on my life.
Last call. I have to tell you about the guy that built the golden chicken coop. Moses, I told you about earlier, you know. But God said, when Moses asked him about it, God just said, where's the beef? I don't do chicken. That, if you know about sacrifices, it required to sacrifice a beef, not a chicken. So you can take God, your fluffy sacrifice, and your golden chicken cage, or we can do it his way. Father, we thank you for your word. We ask you to hide it in our heart and give us hope for the future. For we have complex issues, our fleshman does. Spirit man should not have complex issues. He just should say, yes, my Lord, your will be done. And your joy will flood my soul. Let it be so to us. Your will be done, not ours. In Jesus' great and precious name, we pray for your abiding, directive blessings. Hide your word in our heart, that we would thirst to become your kings and your priest here on earth. In Jesus' name. God bless you. How many of you is going to be there tomorrow so we can plan on dinner? That's lunch for those of you from the south. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, Seven people. All right. Yes, Jackie's going to be there in flying colors. She's got a paintbrush in all three hands. Yes, eight. Just bring it on down and we'll all keep working. That's good. I know that Charlie has said it's one of the highlights of his life. And I'd like to commend you guys, Charlie and Pat and Donna and Elton. You just been there and been there and been there. That's it. That's mine too. It's the way I feel about it, Lord. I looked at the watch this morning. I had an hour and a half of paperwork to do before I got there, and I was about 15, 20 minutes late. And I thought, oh, Lord, I'm late. God bless you guys. Love you guys there in Texas. Hope that you just have a blessed, blessed, blessed time. Love to hear from you, too. Hey, we're burning CDs. If y'all want CDs, you just let us know. God bless. Bye-bye. Butch, Brenda, love you. Oh, that, did the others get mailed out? I didn't mail them. Huh? Oh, she did. Okay. We need somebody to mail something tomorrow, an overnight express. Ah. Oh, not supposed to.